Hello everyone, my name is Isaac Curtis and welcome back to Road to Living Water, the series where I try to teach you what I've learned as a Christian in hopes that it inspires you to do the same, if not more. If you're just now joining us, feel free to watch the previous videos. There's a playlist for this whole series in the description. So today we're diving straight into chapter 4 of Max Lucado's He Still Moves Stones, which is titled, When You and Your Kin Can't, Dealing with Difficult Relatives. He starts off by telling us about a time he was asking his friends a question, and that question was, give me a word picture to describe a relative in your life who really bugs you. One person described his wife's brother as a parasite on his neck. Another called their own mom a cactus wearing a silk shirt, meaning when people get close to her, she's prickly, dry, and thirsty for life. Then Lucado says someone responded with Tar Baby and Brer Rabbit. Am I saying that right? Apparently, it's an old story about a fox who plays a trick on a rabbit. He makes a doll out of tar and then sticks it to the side of the road. The rabbit eventually goes up to it, mistaking it for a person, and then he tries to have a conversation with it. When the doll obviously didn't respond, the rabbit got frustrated and went to hit it. But when he hit it, he stayed stuck to the doll. This is how Lucado describes difficult relatives. He says, we're stuck to someone we can't communicate with. Chances are you have someone in your life like that too, even if it's in the smallest way. Lucado gives descriptions like a mother who whines, an uncle who slurps a soup, which, reading that now, what's the matter with slurping soup? A sister who flaunts her figure, a dad who is waiting for you to get a real job, or a mother-in-law who wonders why her daughter married you. Lucado calls these tar baby relationships, stuck together but falling apart. He says sometimes we have these expectations for our family to be there for us when we're hurting or struggling emotionally, but oftentimes they'll just pull the bystander card. So then he begs the question, what can you do when those closest keep their distance? He brings up a very interesting yet unpredictable example, Jesus's own family. Even Jesus had a difficult family. Sometimes we forget he had legitimate by blood brothers and sisters while he was on earth. Mark 6:3 says, he's just the carpenter, the son of Mary and the brother of James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon. And his sisters live right there among us. Hold on, I have to pause for a minute. There's a meme that's been going around lately that just has traumatized my brain every time I see the word among us.
Ah, it hurts.
Anyways, yes, Jesus had a whole family full of mortals. But the kicker is, Lucado points out that even Jesus's own family didn't appreciate him sometimes. Verse 4 says, then Jesus told them, a prophet is honored everywhere except in his own hometown and among his relatives and his own family. Everyone in Jesus' hometown probably really loved him until he said, oh, by the way, I'm the Messiah. I'm here to fulfill prophecy. And then the people were probably like, no, shut up. Aren't you just a carpenter boy? The people became so irritated that they actually tried to throw Jesus off a cliff. In Luke 4:29, it says, jumping up, they mobbed him and took him to the edge of the hill on which the city was built. They intended to push him over the cliff, but he slipped away through the crowd and left them. Lucado points out that nowhere does it imply Jesus' brothers went to help him. He even suggests they might have been embarrassed by him. Lucado then says, how can you believe in yourself when those who know you best don't? Well, luckily, Jesus has an answer for that. Lucado notes that Jesus never tried to control how his family treats him, nor did he let it get to him. He pretty much didn't try to be a people pleaser. The way Jesus describes his family in Mark 3:35, he says, anyone who does God's will is my brother and sister and mother. I can't help but notice the word father isn't anywhere in that verse, or at least in my version. This is a NLT, by the way, but it's worded differently than the one on the Bible app. But maybe he's hinting at his true father, God. But I think the lesson Lucado is trying to teach here is, if you have difficult family members, you're not here to please them. I'm not saying shut them out, not at all. It's a little difficult to word, but we have no control over what others think of us. And what others think of us can have such a haunting power over our lives, even mine. Like, I don't come on here without a care in the world. I sometimes worry about pleasing others too. It's easy to do, but that's not why we're here. We're here to do God's will. Lucado says, I can't assure you that your family will ever give you the blessing you seek, but I know God will. Let God give you what your family doesn't. If your earthly father doesn't affirm you, then let your heavenly father take his place. Something I've realized recently is when I pray, I only refer to God as Lord. I can't remember a time I've called him father, but a lot of people do that. But I'm also working on my prayer, so hopefully I can get used to doing that more. The point is, we can look at God as our creator, savior. It's really easy to do that. But the whole game changer is when you look at him as father. Someone online once pointed out when you get in a bad situation, the first thing you think is, oh, I gotta call my dad. God is there for all your troubles too, just like a dad. And side note, try not to come to God only about things that are going wrong. Praise him for all he's done and will do too. I used to have that habit too, so that's why I'm mentioning that. In Galatians 4:7, Paul says, now you are no longer a slave, but God's own child. And since you are his child, everything he has belongs to you. This past week, I was at a small group called Ignite. I'm sure y'all are well aware of it. It's the reason I'm making these videos. But last week, someone said, God has given you everything you need already. The rest is just excess. And the analogy he used with that was what God has given you is like a cake, and anything that may come with it is the icing. And what happens if you have too much icing? You get sick. I mean, I don't. I've eaten bowls of that thing and I'm fine. But that's not the point. By the way, in the end, Jesus' family ended up okay. And in Acts 1:14, it says they continued to pray together after Jesus ascended to heaven. Lucado says that Jesus gave them space, time, and grace. And because he did, they changed. One of his brothers even became an apostle. Lucado then ends the chapter with a word of encouragement that says, "So don't lose heart. God still changes families. A tar baby today might be your dearest friend tomorrow." So that's it for this video. Thank you all for watching. I hope it spoke to you in some way, even if I butchered the wording. In the description, there's a ton of links to other stuff like this entire series, my Fiverr account, along with all my art accounts as sort of a demo reel, and even two other channels that are entirely different from this one if you like video games or scary stuff. So again, thank you all for watching, and I will see you all in the next video. I want to know you.